Thank you for coming to the panel four of the conference, Narrating Cold Wars. The subject of this panel is the press, cinema, television, and soft power. I'm Eva Mann, director of the Academy of Film of Hong Kong Baptist University. And we are very happy that altogether we have four presenters at this panel, and each presenter will do their presentation for around 15 minutes, as you were told. And we will have discussion open to the floor after all the presentations through 4:15 p.m., hopefully. So let me introduce the panelists. In the order of appearances or presentations, they are Professor Mireno Berrettini. Hi. Yeah, good to see you. Professor Berrettini is a full professor of history of international relations at the University of Cattolica of Milan. So welcome. Our second speaker is Jennifer Forst. She is a historian of the 20th century United States society, politics and culture, and associate professor at the University of Auckland in New Zealand. Hi, Jennifer. Jennifer, yes, hi, I see you. And so our third speaker, maybe we cannot see him at this moment, is Professor Tarik Amar. Professor Amar is a historian at the Department of History at Cork University, which is situated in Istanbul and Turkey. He is also the author of the very famous book, The Paradox of Ukrainian Life. And our last presenter is Dr. Qi Ai of Shandong University, China. Hi, Dr. Qi. Hi, yeah, good to see you. And Qi Ai is a postdoctoral fellow in media and communication studies at the School of Journalism and Communication of Shandong University, where he also is the Associate Director of Research Center for Culture, Art and Communication of Film and Teleplay. So very happy to have you all. So due to the time constraint, let's start with Mireno's topic. His presentation entitled, Before Being the Cold War, on the origin and transformation of the expression Cold War, unquote, in the Anglo-US press between 1942 to 1950. So please start.
Thank you very much. Sorry, I would like to share my slides, but now the system doesn't work. How can I? I'm here. Sorry, I'm not confident with Zoom. We use another tool for giving lessons. So thank you very much. Thank you to the organizer for this invitation. For me, it's interesting being here because it's the first time I present this research, which is a work in progress, actually. It's a project devoted to the reconstruction of the meanings of the expression Cold War. I will be very short, leaving time for the Q&A, and I use the slide to help me in this presentation. I start with this definition, Cold War, a standard definition of the Cambridge Dictionary. Cold War is defined as a state of extreme unfriendliness existing between countries. And traditionally, it's used in historiography or in political science to describe the relation between the United States and the Soviet Union after the Second World War, World War II. So I want to study the history of this definition. And I studied this definition using the press. Of course, I started with US press and the British press because it's easier, especially during the lockdown situation, because they have built a huge structure, informatic structure. But I'm trying to do the same things here in the old continent using the newspapers or French newspapers, Italian newspapers, and Spanish newspapers. In language morphology, Cold War is a phraseme. It's a very bad word. I write here a lexical construction made up two words. Each of these two words have a meaning if used alone, but if used together, they acquire another dimension of meaning. I say 1 + 1 = 3. And I repeat, I want to study the history of these phrasing. This is a different research path because classically, historiography has been interested in analyzing the origins of Cold War as structure of international system. I want to study the history of the expression Cold War and the cultural construction of this. So my problem is not when the Cold War started or the guilty, brutally speaking, but when we start to use the expression Cold War and the meaning related to this expression. For me, it's interesting because I define Cold War as a sort of Foucaultian dispositive or a shared ontology. It's interesting because in the historical perspective, this shared ontology has been used to understand and to oversimplify the dynamic of international system, especially after the Second World War. And today, it's used to define the relation between two huge players. I refer, of course, United States and Russia, but most of all, United States and People's Republic of China. These are an example of the use of the expression Cold War today, not in an historical manner, but in political scientist way. During my research, I discover, if we can say discover, that the first use of this expression, Cold War, was made by Theodor Bestman, who was a physicist, during a speech in Leamington in UK. It was October 1942, and he was describing during this speech the relation in that moment between the British Empire and the Third Reich. Of course, there was a war, but actually there wasn't a war proper in the old continent, because there was a sort of something between a conflict and a peace. And he used this expression, very peculiar, was the first time it was used in British, in English language, but with definite article A and Cold War, small letters. Then these phrasim appear once again in the British press. In this article of 1943, entitled Freud and Marx, on Manchester Evening News. In this article, the journalists reconstructed the frictions between great power just before the World War II. And he described a sort of long-term confrontation between democracies and totalitarianism. He used this expression, this phrasim, in quotes, just to mark that this expression was very unusual. It was used to describe something hot, but that wasn't hot, was cold, hot like war, but not proper. And it's interesting because for the first time, this expression is linked not just to the confrontation between great powers, but even to the ideological dimension. A clash between two different systems. However, the first use in connection with the structure, with the machinery and the national system, is due to Dorothy Thompson. Dorothy Thompson is one of the most important US journalists. And he wrote almost in the end of the World War II, in January 45, on the Cincinnati Enquirer, this article, The Catastrophe to Threaten the Allied Coalition if Nazi Menace Ceases. He was describing the relation between China, Soviet Union, United States, and British Empire. And he affirmed that the only way to keep this great alliance alive was to continue a Cold War against Germany, creating the perpetual fear of a German rebellion. So his vision probably was right, because at the end of the year, just at the end of World War II, frictions within the Great Alliance started. The Stanley speech of 1946 and the most famous Iron Curtain speech of Winston Churchill. This article, the article of Dorothy Thompson, actually was repeated and repeated and repeated in many little newspapers across the US mainland. And this is interesting because it started to create a common vision of what Cold War was. This dimensional meaning didn't have further development, because later arrived probably one of the most important journalists or political thinker that we have in the British world in that time. It's George Orwell. He wrote two articles. That's very famous. These two articles are considered the first actually use of the term Cold War in the US expression, in the US and in the Anglo-Saxon world. And it's right, but is the first use just to describe the general machinery of international system. Dorothy Thompson was used to describe the international system, but just related to the relation between the Great Alliance and Germany. Now, George Orwell described the entire machinery of the international system. It's very similar to the definition that we use. He stated in the first article, You and the Atomic Bomb, that in the future, every state, especially the four great powers, will be in, quote, permanent state of Cold War with its neighbors. It was due to the impossibility to wage war due to nuclear weapons. And then he wrote another article almost a year, some month later. And he described the Cold War as a new version of the Great Game, the Anglo-Russian Great Game. So he described the frictions between the Soviet Union and the British Empire across the Rhineland. So the main point for George Orwell were the mutual assured destruction, the use of nuclear weapons, and on the other side, the geopolitics. But he gave to these expression a fourth dimension, an ideological dimension. Once again, it was the British word. It talked about propaganda, agencies, and the problem between democracies and totalitarianism. So it was the British link, the British word that linked this phraseme to the a sort of multidimensional confrontation, not just geopolitical, but multidimensional. And these are two other examples of this long-term process. An article appeared on the Aberdeen Press and Journal, and another article on the World and the Guardian. All these articles, many other, transformed the meaning of the Cold War, not just geopolitical confrontation among four great powers, but geopolitical confrontation between the Anglo-Saxon world and the Soviet Union. This is normal, because in this phase we are in 46, historiography has discovered that the most serious frictions were those between United Kingdom and the Soviet Union. Because in this moment, United States was a sort of peculiar isolationist situation. And actually the cultural world of US linked to the Western Europe used the phraseme, used the expression Cold War to fight, we can say, the isolationist position. You can discover in all the articles related to the expression Cold War, the critics to all the politicians that wanted to come back home. So the expression Cold War was used to fuel the projection, the power and economic projection of US across the Atlantic. In some cases, and this is a peculiar in these two articles, the expression Cold War was used to criticize the anti-British position of the Washington administration. In that moment, there was a problem about the structure of the new international trade system. Mm? There was the long wave of a Bretton Woods battle. We can say this expression. So in certain areas of the US political world, the main problem wasn't just the Soviet Union. Of course, Soviet Union was a problem, but the British Empire system of preferences in the economic dimension was another problem. From this moment onward, all the issues, all the problem, all the frictions, or just the negotiation between the Western democracies and the Soviet Union started to be ridden through the lenses of this expression, Cold War. Mm. The first example is the Truman Doctrine, one of the most important moments in the definition of US position in the new international system. Actually, President Truman didn't use the expression Cold War, but the Anglo-US press reacted by translating, we can say, this speech in a Cold War vocabulary. And an example, the Chicago Tribune entitled an article, A Cold War Speech to Describe the Position of Truman. So once again, we have a transformation, not just geopolitics, against the loser of a Cold War, not just geopolitics and ideological dimension to describe the machinery of international system, but now the Cold War is linked to the relation between a totalitarian state like the Soviet Union and the Western free world. And then we have another point, and I think this is interesting. I'm running. Try to give you all the details of my presentation. Then there is another dimension. This is due to Bernard Baruch, a businessman, is very close to the Truman administration, and he gave an important speech in a South Carolina legislature, and he said that, I quote, "We are today in the midst of a Cold War, and our enemies are to be found abroad at home and at home. The tycoon asked for a sort of union sacrée in the labor relations. He asked for a crackdown on strikes, and he asked a sort of union for defending the American way of life, there is a misprint. Baruch's word was repeated like advertisement on all of these newspapers. And all of these newspapers use in some cases the expression a Cold War speech. So Cold War now is a confrontation between the Westerners, mainly UK and US, and the Soviet Union on the other part, had an ideological dimension, the defense of democracy against a totalitarian wave. And then you have a little bit a new meaning, which is the defense of the American way of life against the home socialists or home communists. And then we have the final step, the canonization of this expression and the transformation from the Cold War, a generic Cold War with small letters, to the Cold War with capital. And this is due to Walter Lippmann. He wrote this book, which is very important, of course, it's very famous in historiography. And he, thanks to his position, actually, and the success, the great success of this book, the expression Cold War was directly linked with all these meaning that I show you. It's interesting that the thesis of the position of Walter Lippmann were repeated and reprinted in all these little newspapers, little or big newspapers across the US mainland. So once again, the power of press was to shape the mind of US citizenship, linking these meanings to their vision, created a sort of actually shared ontology. I repeat, the most important thing is the switch from the A to the. This gave coherence and reify a process, an event. And from this moment onward, it was conceived as a unified and a unique way. The Cold War that we saw in the Cambridge Dictionary. I actually ran. Sorry, was really brutal. Conclusions. In the origin, the expression Cold War did not refer to the structure of international system, but to the way it worked. In political science, political scientists have clear that the Cold War is a synonymous of bipolar order. In history, things are more complicated. And actually, we know that in its origins, it was not related to the concept of bipolar order, because actually it was shaping the first time talking about the Grand Alliance, the Great Alliance, so four great powers, four superpowers, and China was included. It's not linked to the expression superpower, and the meaning changed in relation to the international and internal needs of the US and British policy, so a process of transformation. It's interesting that a review like Foreign Affairs, very important, no need to say, used this formula only from October 1950, and used this formula for the first time in two articles related to the Asia Pacific. This is important to my other researchers. I'm trying to overcome the Eurocentric bias of the Cold War narrative. So in my perception, Asia Pacific and actually the role of People's Republic of China is central to understand the genesis of the structure of international system during the Cold War. But this is another conference. And it's not the case that in the same year, Sir William Stanley was a permanent undersecretary of Foreign Affairs, wrote a memorandum on the use of term Cold War. He stated it's the very dangerous expression. Please be quiet and ponder the use. I say it's an invitation not accepted. This expression has and had today a great success, but the problem is the oversimplification that this expression created. So thank you. I'm sorry because I ran actually. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mireno. Thank you for your quick review and reflection and the good references you have provided. I think our researchers will be very benefit from all this that you have provided. So now we have to come to the second presenter, Jennifer Force of University of Auckland. She will present on a very interesting topic called Stanley Kramer, Hollywood Liberalism and the Cold War. Thank you, Jennifer. Please start.
Thank you for having me. And I have been quite looking forward to this conference, the call for papers, talking about popular culture and counter narratives just leaped off the screen at me. And it's wonderful to be here. So today I want to talk about Stanley Kramer. And he was the topic of my 2017 book, Producer of Controversy, Stanley Kramer, Hollywood Liberalism and the Cold War. And he was the most prominent liberal American filmmaker of the Cold War era. He was a producer, director, and an early and successful independent filmmaker, starting really in the post-World War II period. He enjoyed a lengthy and prolific career from the 1940s to the 1980s. and he began his career in the US motion picture industry just as the old studio system was breaking up. And he had production and distribution agreements with a few companies, Columbia Pictures and United Artists, but he was able to use his freedom as an independent producer and then director over the years to make 29 films. 15 of these films he also directed, and of which 4 were nominated for Best Picture Academy Award. As a producer-director, Kramer became best known for making social problem films, films that took as their subject matter a problem or conflict in the society, and for his liberal politics. Now, the years that marked the start and greatest successes of his career as an independent producer in Hollywood were 1947 to 1963. And those years took the United States and the Soviet Union from open declared hostility to a nuclear test ban treaty. Throughout his career, but especially during these years, Kramer operated at the intersection of popular and political culture, profoundly shaped by the Cold War. Attention to this Hollywood liberal reveals a counter narrative that departs from both conservative and liberal anti-communism in the United States, with differing consequences for domestic and foreign policy. Kramer's early career coincided with the start of the Cold War abroad and at home. In October 1947, and we've just heard from Mireno, thank you, talking about the Truman Doctrine. That's happening at the level of international politics. In national politics and in Hollywood, 1947 is the same year that the House Committee on Un-American Activities launched its post-war Hollywood hearings. It's the same year that Kramer starts his first successful production company. Now, the HUAC hearings, as they were known, were based on the premise that communists had successfully inserted propaganda into American movies. And the hearings spurred the motion picture industry to institute the blacklist, which basically contributed not only to the stifling of social criticism and political dissent in Cold War America, but specifically prevented the hiring of anybody who was a real or a suspected communist. Now, as a political liberal committed to making films that reflected his social conscience, Kramer negotiated a political landscape dominated by conservative anti-communists and their Red Scare politics. He both compromised with and challenged these forces over the late 1940s and 1950s. He occupied what I call the liberal middle ground in Hollywood, but his affinities and affiliations were actually left-leaning. Many colleagues in his production company were soon caught up in the Red Scare. An FBI informant said the Kramer outfit, quote, is red from top to bottom. His friend, screenwriter, and former communist Carl Foreman was the best known example. Their falling out after Foreman refused to fully testify before HUAC in 1951, basically Foreman took what was called a qualified Fifth Amendment where he would testify about his own communist background, but not name names or any of his comrades in the Communist Party. So he refuses to testify fully. Kramer demanded that he do this. And when he didn't, they had a falling out that ended their business relationship and their personal relationship. This break has become legendary in Hollywood history. Now for Kramer later, he said, I could not have stood by him. I couldn't have defended him. He said, I would have been blackballed and maybe driven out of the industry for something which I had not taken part in. Now, in hindsight, as scholar Larry Seplar argues, both men's actions resulted from conflicting but not dishonorable loyalties and principles. They were decent men confronted with indecent circumstances over which they had no control. So Kramer did not come to the defense of Foreman in 1951, but he never wavered in his strong opposition to anti-communism. As his success grew and political repression in Hollywood somewhat eased, he began to take very public stands against anti-communist forces. In 1957 and 1958, he purchased the rights to a novel by Howard Fast, who had left the Communist Party only the year before. He also purchased the rights to an original screenplay co-authored by Harold Jacob Smith and blacklisted actor and writer Nedrick Young. When the red-baiting American Legion condemned Kramer for these purchases, he justified his decisions. "It's unfortunate," he said, "that members of the film industry have at one time or another been censured for past political affiliations. Instead," he argued, "they deserve, quote, complete freedom of expression." So he's making these arguments in 1959 and 1960 in what is seen as the first, along with Otto Preminger, a really strong statement of free speech rights that need to be upheld in the motion picture industry. Now, his stance led to a confrontation and public debate with the American Legion in newspapers, on television, in letters, about the morality and the necessity of the Hollywood blacklist. Among other factors, including Otto Preminger's stance, this debate is credited with helping to bring about the end of the blacklist by the early 1960s. Now, Kramer reached the peak of his career in the late 1950s and early 1960s, just as the domestic consensus on the Cold War became increasingly questioned, and the two superpowers began to restore cultural relations. During this period, he was dubbed Hollywood's producer of controversy, and he released a film every year. The Defiant Ones in 1958, On the Beach in 1959, Inherit the Wind in 1960, and Judgment at Nuremberg in 1961. These films dealt respectively with American race relations, threat of nuclear war, violations of free thought and expression, and Nazi crimes and the Holocaust. His films' liberal themes of racial and ethnic tolerance, freedom of thought and expression, and peaceful coexistence between the United States and the Soviet Union meant they were categorized as message movies. It was a term he hated because he felt it marginalized his work. And of course, we know all movies carry messages. The political messages of his films provoked controversy and charges of didacticism, but they also made them relevant to contemporary issues and debates. The Defiant Ones appeared the year following the Little Rock, Arkansas school integration crisis, which was eventually resolved when President Dwight D. Eisenhower dispatched federal troops to the city. And this is an event that loomed quite large in Soviet propaganda against the United States. On the Beach's international premiere occurred against the backdrop of calls for US-Soviet agreements on limiting nuclear testing. Inherit the Wind's story of civil rights under assault in Tennessee in the 1920s contributed to public discussion about ending the Hollywood blacklist. And Judgment at Nuremberg, while set in 1948 during the Nuremberg trials for Nazi war crimes, screened just after the second Berlin crisis and the Adolf Eichmann trial. The public discussion these films provoked intersected with the Cold War at home and abroad. The Defiant Ones provoked disputes about race, racism, and the civil rights movement, and how these were received and perceived overseas. On the Beach contributed to global dialogue about the nuclear arms race. Inherit the Wind prompted debate about the Hollywood blacklist and civil liberties. And Judgment in Nuremberg concerned Nazi war crimes and the Holocaust with an important subplot about how the Cold War and the alliance with West Germany led to official American reluctance to confront the Nazi past. These discussions that the films provoked among various audiences, critical, political, popular, contributed to the impact of Kramer's films at home and abroad. These four films led to really Kramer's most peak moment in terms of his national reputation in the United States when he wins the Irving Thalberg Award in 1962 at the Academy Awards for creative producers and his contribution to the film industry. And he's pictured here with Maximilian Schell, who won Best Actor for his role in Judgment and Nuremberg. But these films also established Kramer's international reputation. They were screened at film festivals, and he emerged as an important political and cultural figure on the international stage, just at this moment in the thaw in Cold War relations between the United States and the Soviet Union. As we all know, in 1958, the two governments signed the Historic Cultural Agreement, and Kramer's films were among the first American films to be screened in the Soviet Union following the agreement. And Moscow was also one of the world cities in which On the Beach premiered in December 1959. While the Soviets purchased annually only 4 or 5 Hollywood films during the years of the Cultural Agreement, they purchased 7 of Kramer's over the period, the most of any US filmmaker. Kramer became quite well known and well liked in the Soviet Union among government officials, filmmakers, critics, and audiences. Indeed, he enjoyed greater critical respect there than in the United States. In a 1967 review, one Soviet film critic discussed films by major artists such as Fellini, Antonioni, and Kramer. These are 3 names you would never see linked together anywhere else. The Soviets invited Kramer to first visit in 1960, but he could not accept until 1963 on the occasion of the 3rd Biennial Moscow International Film Festival. Now, US government officials worried that his controversial films and his festival participation would provide fodder for Soviet propaganda. But Kramer rejected such limits on his freedom of expression and action. Limits paradoxically put in place to fight a Cold War in defense of freedom. In the free world, he said, the artist must have freedom of expression. This is basic. It must be whole, not partial, he argued. And he believed that his movies demonstrated that freedom and thus played an important ideological role in the Cold War. He went to Moscow, served and took a leading role on the jury, introduced American films, and proclaimed his commitments to artistic freedom, civil liberties, and liberal internationalism. The prominence and impact of Kramer's participation in the 1963 Moscow Film Festival solidified his reputation with the Soviets, the US Department of State, and the American public. Outstanding personage at the festival, undoubtedly Stanley Kramer, telegrammed the US Embassy in Moscow to the State Department after the close of the festival. Kramer participated in the Moscow Film Festival again in 1967 and in 1971, and both of those years were quite controversial for US participation. In 1967, due to the Arab-Israeli war, and in 1971, the Nixon administration called for a boycott of the film festival in Moscow because of quote-unquote anti-American propaganda. Kramer went because he believed cultural connections, communication was absolutely vital among nations. He won the prize for Best Picture in 1973 at the Moscow Film Festival for his film Oklahoma Crude, and was cited for his humanist contribution to the development of world cinema. In these ways, Kramer can be viewed as a crucial participant in US cultural diplomacy during the Cold War. As we well know, cultural diplomats shaped the ideological and symbolic struggle that was as much part of the US Cold War strategy as military, diplomatic, and economic aspects. Kramer's films, public persona and actions, and the public debate around both complicate dominant narratives about Cold War consensus and conflict in the United States. He represented a third way, neither communist nor anti-communist, critical of the lack of civil rights and liberties on both sides of the Iron Curtain, and devoted to liberal internationalism. Kramer reminds us of the political alternatives available to Americans and the rest of the world in that historical moment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Jennifer. You have led us to revisit the person and the work of Stanley Kramer, and with your very rich research findings, and I really learned so much from it. Thank you. So we will open a discussion for your paper after all the presentations. And now we have to come to our third presenter, Professor Tarik Amar of Cork University. Oh, I can see you now. We can see you now. Great. Yeah, well, your topic of presentation is really interesting and specific. It's on how East Germany saved, some of the world, the invisible visitor 1970s Cold War Intelligence TV series as a fantasy of cosmopolitanism and global influence. I don't think I've seen the TV series, so I have to learn it from you. So please start. Yeah, this is your time.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much also for not only for your very kind words and introduction, but also for your invitation and the opportunity to present some of this research here. My apologies again for the initial technical troubles, which I think were entirely on our side, having nothing to do with you. We have another machine now. So I'm going to share my screen with a Prezi presentation and explain some of the aspects of my ongoing research into this series. I should perhaps say at the very beginning that I can only really raise a fragment of all the things that are, I think, interesting in this topic. If there are questions, of course, we can then address them during the Q&A, and please do point out to me when I run out of time. Let's see, where is my Prezi? I had it. Oh, come on. Where is my Prezi?
Yes.
I've seen it. Wait a minute, it must be here somewhere. Oh God, why is my Prezi gone? It's here, okay. Can you see it now? Hello, can
you see my Prezi? No, not yet, you know, we see just a security page.
Okay, that's not good. I'm sorry, this is one of those days. Here it is. Now you will be able to see it.
I think. Yes. Now we see it. Thank you.
So to give you a very, very quick aesthetic taste, as it were, of what this series felt like, right? I'm going to play the introduction now. It's just a few seconds, half a minute, to one of its many films. Snazzy, very 70s, as you can see. So one very important term that we've heard here is, I think, the German word Kundschafter, and we will come back to that. To begin with, however, I would like to give you a very quick overview over the thing as a whole, which was quite a big phenomenon. I won't go into the details, don't be afraid, but what this slide shows you immediately is that there were a total of 16 films made in this sort of serious franchise that was shown between 1973 and 1979 on East German TV. They all came under this general heading of the invisible visor, or in German, das unsichtbare Visier. I have divided them, this is very much my own doing, this is not common in the literature, into two big parts. The first part featured a single hero and was really quite different from the second part, which featured, as you can see, a team of agents, and also in other respects was different, but we can talk about this in the Q&A if you wish. I today will talk about this second part. One of the reasons why I'm restricting myself to that is that it's very pragmatic that I have done a lot of work on the first part already for a book that I'm currently finishing, and I was always eager to address the second part in more detail. It was called a Kundschafter-Serie, so it was a film series, a franchise really, about Kundschafter. We'll talk about this term in a second. It was extremely successful in East Germany at the time. In the German term is a Straßenfeger, which is really a blockbuster in English. And it was very much, this is important to know, a deliberate attempt by the East German combined secret police and intelligence service the Ministry of State Security, usually known as the Stasi, from Staatssicherheit, State Security, at PR, at public relations. And sometimes people think I'm using a very Western term here, but public relations is really literally the translation of what they called it themselves. The Stasi uses the term Öffentlichkeitsarbeit, which is exactly a translation of public relations in German. It was built as fiction very much. People were told this is fictitious, the heroes are fictitious heroes, but at the same time, and this is very important, people were also told that it is fundamentally true, that, you know, in principle, what you see here is has a claim to truth. Let's go back now to the question of the Kundschafter. Now, I see the question of the Kundschafter in German very much as a subset of a general phenomenon that happens during the Cold War, which I call, for want of better terms, really, the glorification of the spy. In East Germany, this had various aspects, and again, they were not all unique. They were also not specifically socialist slash communist or even authoritarian. Some of these aspects are very similar in Western capitalist, free market, democratic, whatever you call them, regimes at the same time. One is immediately that you have a fantasy of empowerment, of what is really a mid-sized power at best, right? East Germany is a dependent client of the Soviet Union, the way that West Germany is a client of the United States at the same time. Of course, in the West, we usually call it ally, not client, because we want to be kind to our own side. But the situation is quite similar. These are mid-sized powers. They don't call the shots in the Cold War world. And what a secret agent series allows you to do is spin tales about how ultimately your agents secretly are extremely important after all. And of course, this is a pattern that we know from perhaps the most important or most famous fictitious secret agent of them all during the Cold War, namely James Bond, right? James Bond is built exactly on the same principle, at least the films very much are. He's a British agent. Britain is a power clearly in decline. The loss of India, talk Suez. But in the movies and the stories, it's not the CIA, it's not the Americans, it's the British and James Bond who again and again are decisive in saving the world. It's a very similar type of pattern you would see in The Invisible Visor. Now, things that are much more specific, right, that are really not common with other Cold War cases, at least not necessarily in the West, are things such as that these people are very much presented as part of an international class struggle that's explicit still, even in the 70s. They are presented as preserving international peace. This is actually one of their key missions, and it's what's mentioned right in this, at the beginning of the series, in this opener that I've just showed you, right? It says, this is a team of Kundschafter, of agents, who are fighting for the preservation of international peace on an invisible front. And that's no accident at all. They're definitely not presented as mere patriots, right? They're not just fighting for their country, even for its legitimate interests. They're fighting for the whole world. They're even sort of constantly saving the West and capitalism from its own worst tendencies, namely to create war. This is why they're also presented as representing a certain type of humanism. What is also very important in the East German case, I think, is this is a country that after all, especially after 1961, is locking in most of its population in reality, most of the time. But this is a fantasy of travel and cosmopolitanism, right? These are agents who literally travel the world. They're not only active in West Germany at all, though this is of course very important in their activities. They also go to Argentina, to South Africa, to Italy, to Corsica, to France, you name it, right? So they're a projection of international, indeed global influence. And we can, of course, again, talk more about this if you wish. Now, here's a specific thing I would like to talk about. And it's only one aspect I have picked out here for this presentation to fit into the time, which is the Kundschafter, the scout, the agent. By the way, it's a calque from Russian, a direct calque from Russian, Rasvechik, which is a Russian term for an agent, a good agent, a Russian agent during the Cold War, which also means a scout, right? So here we have the scout, the Kundschafter, the good type of agent who works on the side of socialism and East Germany. And one of the things they do in the second big half of Visor, these seven movies that are shown between 77 and 1979, is they have a very specific relationship to people in the West. And here, of course, I don't mean the opponents, which is either the West German Secret Service, the BND especially, and the MRD, or the CIA, or sometimes it's the South African Secret Service, and so on and so on. I don't mean that. I mean the relationship that is shown that they have with ordinary people in the West. Now, obviously, this is an incredibly idealized picture, right? So what you will not find is what the Stasi was really doing, which was blackmail, Romeo agents, the targeted exploitation of romantic and sexual relationships, and so on, right? Stasi work was at least as dirty as real secret services are in reality, of course, so don't get me wrong. But here we are talking about an idealized and ideologized picture, obviously, right? Made, after all, for Stasi public relations. And in this picture, they play the role of, first of all, guardian angel, right? So in the first major story, what happens is that they have to prevent or sabotage in some way a secret cooperation between West Germany and South Africa, trying to transfer technology to the South African apartheid regime in return for West Germany being able to develop weapons there, and especially nuclear weapons, which of course was the thing that West Germany never really got to, but here it's posited as a secret aim. In the plot, around, which is very complicated, and I won't go into it, what happens is that they try to save this guy, Jürgen Machholz, who is a West German engineer, actually working for this type of research, but he also becomes its victim because he's contaminated with a chemical agent and he's trying to save himself. He might even be trying to become a whistleblower. It's never quite clear. They try to protect him, but they fail. He dies anyhow. They can't save him. This is the scene where finally one of the agents, Tanner, here in the left, meets him at the very last moment of his life. And he, and this is very, very typical for the attitude that is depicted in the series. He says to him, "I only want to help you, Mr. Machholz," right? This is the message. I'm not here to protect the interests of East Germany. I'm not here to fight West Germany on the invisible front. I'm here to help you. And he can't. But in return, the team of agents does manage to save his wife, Eva Machholz, who is also targeted by the sinister forces of CIA, South African Secret Service, West German Secret Service. And that is a constellation that in a way reminds me of Western series such as, drawing a blank, Mission Impossible, the original, right? A team of agents that intervenes and sometimes even saves ordinary people. There is another big story, the second one, very strange, where the basic plot is that the CIA is running secret experiments with psychological chemical weapons in West Germany. So they contaminate the drinking water and so on to see how certain drugs will affect certain parts of the population. This is, of course, an allusion to Project MK Ultra that is real in the history of the CIA and the United States. This is a technique that was very often used in Invisible Visor. The plots are not well made. They're actually insane in many ways and very badly written at this point. But they often use a fragment of something real and play with it, right? And this is happening here too. So there's an allusion to experiments, illegitimate experiments with psychological warfare drugs. This is projected on West Germany. And what is interesting in our context is that here as well, a Stasi agent, Alexander, you see him here, saves an ordinary West German. And it's also, in this case, a blossoming romantic relationship. I won't go into the details. I will just tell you that she is from a very wealthy background. She's very much depicted as a daughter of the capitalist bourgeoisie. Her father is a horrible person, accordingly, and commits suicide at the end. But she frees herself from this environment. And at the end, it's a little bit like in the film The Graduate, the Stasi agent Alexander and she will together escape. And what is extremely interesting here is another key scene where Alexander here speaks to Dr. Clemens, who is his leader, the leader of the team of East German agents, and says, I have to go and see Georgia, that's her name. Right now, there's no one who needs me more. And Clemens, who here represents the authority of the Stasi, the leadership really, agrees, completely agrees. And I really want to draw your attention to this, how entirely romanticized and unrealistic this is, right? This is a spy leader agreeing that the most important mission now of one of his most important agents is to risk his cover by going and save the girl he has a romantic relationship with, right? This is all the more interesting because initially, Alexander, this is the scene where that happens, builds that romantic relationship, obviously in typical spy manner, to get access to her and her family. But it turns out different. And not only will he save her and drive away with her in his car, the last scene of the movie, he will also have the blessing of his superior, Dr. Clemens, which I think is very telling and very deliberate. And now we come to the third case, and it's my last case in this presentation. In the third big adventure, which is called the Island of Death, the Insel des Todes, which is set in France, Mediterranean France, a little bit on Corsica as well, we see another step, which I find extremely interesting. There we have a Westerner, a French engineer called Marcel Lafitte, who actually turns into the main hero. If you watch these films of Visor, they are much more about Lafitte than about the team of agents. It's literally, he's at the center then. And his story is that in a false flag terrorist campaign that is supported by the West Germans and the CIA, the Italian Secret Service or a network of Italian neo-fascists who are connected to the Italian Secret Service and also pose as Maoists, we can talk about this, conduct terrorist attacks in Italy. And this is, of course, again, an allusion to what was called the strategy of tension or the years of lead in Italy. And there is a bit of a real background again that is sort of reworked here into a fictitious story involving East German agents. During one of these attacks, his family or part of his family, apart from one daughter, is murdered and he becomes an avenger, right? Very classical plot. He also happens to be a former soldier of the Foreign Legion or of the paratroopers in France. He was in the war in Algeria and he's an explosive expert. So all of this taken together, of course, equips him with the skill to infiltrate this network of neo-fascist, Italian Secret Service, West German Army, CIA, and take revenge on them, right? And this is what he does. And this is really the main story of this installment of Visor. And in the process, not only do the East German agents, the Kundschafter, become merely his assistants, he actually saves one of them repeatedly, right? Let me repeat this. In this story, it's the Westerner who's not a communist, who's not a socialist, who joins the struggle for reasons of personal revenge, who actually becomes the main figure and on whom this member of the Stasi team, Winnie Winkelmann, twice depends for her life. Twice he has to save her, not vice versa. So what does all of this, and that was the end of Visor, right? Visor was supposed to go on after this, but it didn't. I suspect, and this is purely speculative, that this character, the Frenchman, who's not a socialist initially, not a communist, not a lefty, was being set up to become a key figure actually in the next Visor installments, which would have been a very interesting thing to see, but Visor actually doesn't continue after this for many complicated reasons. Now, what does this picture of this evolving relationship to the ordinary people in the West tell us, right? So one thing it is, I think, is a very clear reflection of official GDR thinking on the topic of intelligence. In official GDR thinking, East German thinking, you can find this written down explicitly, for example, by a guy called Karl-Heinz Biernat, who was a Marxism-Leninism scholar at the Party Institute, or the Marxism-Leninist Institute attached to the party, sort of a East German think tank, right? Their Atlantic Council, as it were. So Biernat makes very clear in one of his texts that he says, first of all, intelligence conducted for what he calls the world socialist system under the leadership of the Soviet Union is always legitimate. It's not spying, it's something much better. Secondly, if a Western citizen, a citizen of a capitalist imperialist state and so on, participates and helps, that's also legitimate. It's not treason, right? Because they're helping the greater cause in history. That's very, very clear. Now, that's simple, right? But here we see another step being taken, which is that actually the Stasi team begins to protect these Western citizens. And in the end, the Stasi team actually is pushed into the background by one of them. I think what this indicates is a sort of rise to globalism of the series, right? The series thinking scope gets ever bigger. And what it sort of tends to towards the end is to imply that this cause that we are working for, that our Kundschafter are working for, is so truly international or internationalist that actually the outsider, the Westerner, if qualified, if doing the right thing, can not only join, can not only be protected by us, but can become the key figure. I would like to leave it here. I don't know if I'm still within time. I hope I am. And if you have questions also about other aspects, obviously, of this series, then I hope we will have time in the Q&A. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Tarik. Thank you very much. You're really putting the 1970 Cold War intelligence TV series on a bigger world map and mentioning the humanism agenda, which I think will be open for critical discussion very soon. But very informational. They are actually quite very, juicy. I hope that I have a chance to see those TV series. But due to the time constraint, now we have to come to the last speaker of this panel, which is Chi-Ai of Shandong University. And Chi-Ai will present on also related subject called the anti-spy films in 1978 and 1979. The subtitle is Revival and Transition. So please, Chi-Ai.
Okay. Yeah, I'm quite happy to be here to share my new search around genre studies. Actually, it's about the IT spy films. I guess most of you may know it, and some of you may don't know it. So I just show a brief definition for you. The IT spy film, or 反特片 in Chinese, refer to the film made from the 1950s to the 1970s, which centered around how the national security agent, undercover investigators, and frontier guard fight battles with and courage with spies. The film of this category package patriotism and socialist peripheries within suspenseful, exciting, and sometimes thrilling in order to educate the masses in entertainment manner to be on the alert for the potential sabotage from the hostile force in their daily life. I argue that the film of this category has a political attribute, which I summarize as a political education embedded in entertainment. This idea actually is based on Wu Qiong's argument that I mentioned here, and also Dai Jinghua's idea, which she qualified the film of this category as a distinct sub or quasi genre. So first, I will introduce a bit the changes in the film's motive to help you see the features of the film and help you understand the development of the genre and why I focus on the 2-year period. In 1940s, as you can see here, the main motive is spy infiltration. And the film story usually includes the elements of IT-Japanese aggression, national united in the World War II, and the discursive right to reference China. There are two famous examples, maybe not that famous. The first one is Rebirthing in First. This film is about Ripental Trader. And another one is called Code Number One. And this film is about a brief lone hero infiltrating the enemy. And in the 1950s, the motive was changed to show the story about rising political plots of the Kuomintang in Taiwan and the United States. The film of this time corresponded to the then mission of consolidating the socialist regime and eliminated the destructive threats. The film usually includes the elements here. And the film story have a fifth titan. It's the brave lone hero meets a female spy, the Chinese version of female fatale. And the hero wins the victory under the leadership of the party and with the help of the masses. As you can see in this film.
Hello, Chiai.
Yeah.
Are you showing your PowerPoint or do you have anything to share on screen? Because we can't see.
I think I'll show it.
Oh, no, see.
No, we didn't see anything.
Oh,
yes,
sorry.
You please share. Please share now.
All right.
Yeah, great. We see it now. So you can go down to the slide that you are now presenting. I don't know which slide you have reached. Yes.
Okay. So the story usually is about a brief lone hero meets a female spy, the Chinese version of female fatale. And the hero with victory under the leadership of the party and with the help of the masses. And as you can see in the film, there is a line regularly appear in the film. It's called the masses have sharp eyes. So it's quite interesting. This motive was changed in 19, that's the examples, the poster of the film in the 1950s. So in the 1960s, the motive was changed. The story usually revolves around the class struggle and the struggle between the political guidelines. So the convention narrative pattern became like the hero who makes mistakes when the final victory by insisting on the correct political guideline. And this pattern, that's an example of the film in the 1960s. Yeah, that's the posters. Yes, the narrative pattern in the 1970s returned to the classic narrative in the 1950s. So the film rethink the Cultural Revolution and dilute the motive for class struggle. And the main story became a catching spice with ambiguous identity of certain countries. Yeah, that's the example of the film at that time. As you can see, at this time, the government or the film authorities, they produce more IT spy films than they did in the 1960s or the 1950s. Yeah, that's the posters. So in the 1980s, the IT spy film developed to the police and urban crime films, catching sectors who damage and disrupt social order, and rethinking the mystic of a cultural revolution became the key topic of this film. I'll show you. Yes, that's the examples of the film at that time. So the right spy image or catching spy stories did not frequently appear on the screen until the 2000s. And as you can see, the film authority they support some television dramas like The Plot Against in the 2006 and Undercover in 2009 and some films in the 2009. Yeah, that's the posters of television dramas, like the posters of the films. So given the development stated before, it is clear to see how the IT spy film roles in the 1950s changed in the 1960s and revived to the classic version in the late 1970s and developed towards to crime film in 1980s. In fact, a lot of academic attention has been paid to the transition, such as the scholars I mentioned before, Wu Qiong and Dai Jinghua. However, most literature focuses little on the situation at the turning point of the last transition, namely the period from the 1978 to the 1979, particularly the time period when the three black triangle was released to the time when murdering 405 was released. So this paper will focus on the easily ignored period to integrate the revival of the genre with attention to its ideological attribute and then the political context. I will ask several questions to help the paper. So the first one was, why does the genre quickly rise again at a revival to the classic pattern? And what is the connection between this revival and the genre ideological attribute? And what does this connection project on producing the film of this category? For example, changing its genre image. And through the changes, how does the production of the genre participate in the China's national narrative during the Cold War at the turn of the 1980s. Attention paid to the formation's context raises the question, why does this research period matter? So I showed some influential issues happened at that time, as you can see here. In the 1970s, 78, after the Cultural Revolution, the government readjust its political guidelines, correcting the mistakes of Cultural Revolution, initiating the economic reform, and brought the country back to order. A new relation with the Kuomintang government was established along with the issued document, message to the compatriots in Taiwan. The PRC government established its diplomatic relation with the with the United States in 1979, while its strengthened relation with the Soviet Union still exists. So what I can say is the tension from the Sino-Soviet minds were heightened at that time. Clearly, this changes suggest that the PRC has changed its position during the Cold War. The party jumped out ideological confrontation initiated by the Soviet Union and United States and turned to develop the country in its own flexible and pragmatic way. The genre, the IT spy film itself is of a political sensibility, following the party's policy and conducting patriotic education. For the genre development, one can see the continuity of its function as propaganda tool. For example, when the Hollywood launched James Bond film series, in which the Foyt character is a member of Spectre, such as Dr. No, who is easily associated with the right version of Fu Manchu in the 1950s. Sorry, forgot it. It was a time when the IT spy film was popular in the PRC. It was like there was a little cultural interaction between the PRC and the West at that time. This coincidence more or less suggests that the political sensibility of the genre, i.e. the film production of the genre, was to answer the smear. So my paper argues that the genre transient revival as quickly transformation are due to its genre ideological attribute. And this attribute decided how the genre develops and leads to the changes in both icons and convention. For example, as a propaganda tool that packaged political education in entertainment, the IT spy films corresponded to the new political context in the late 1970s. This makes IT spy films ambiguity in the terms of the foreign character's political identity. And the relevant story revolves around protecting the national defense industry. And, you know, it is a guarantee for the country's economic reform at that time. And the narrative in first sight on the catching spy process, and already know its ending abrupt. So this film highlights more by their attitudement rather than the cleft relation to the ideological. So we can see this genre, the production of this genre, we can regard it as a mission of political mission of the government at that time. So it has an entertainment popularity at that time. And this popularity, in fact, endorsed reform and related policies. Actually, it's quite simple because I focus on the genre studies and use textual analysis. So it's not a, what I'm meant to say. Yes, that's all the presentation. That's all the contents of my presentation. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Aichi. And you have delivered very clear methodology and research focus. And then you have mentioned really interesting period, even though it is just 1 year in length between 1978 to 79. But we all know that, you know, there were so much political changes and social changes just between the fall of the Gang of Four to Deng Xiaoping's economic reform. So I'm quite sure that, you know, the spy, anti-spy films have a lot of revelations, which will be open to the floor for discussion. So let's give an applause to all the presenters because, you know, we are now going to open the discussion to the floor. Thank you very much. Yes. So for those participants online, please feel free to utilize our Q&A platform to write and present your comments or questions. And we will check them from time to time till we still have 15 minutes for open discussion. So during the period before we can see the questions, let me have a very brief response to all the presenters. And I would like to start with Mireno. I have a very general question for Mireno, which I am looking forward to learn from you. Is the term Cold War, give a very good introduction and reflection and review of how the term has come out and how it has developed. But what do you perceive now? Because, you know, it seems like the term is receiving some of the new meaning after Trump's regime until now because of the tension between, very obviously China and the US. So do you think that the meaning of the Cold War is also developing, and do you see that it is receiving new meanings? Yeah.
Thank you for the question. It's very interesting and very complicated given an answer proper. Well, I think, of course, in some dimension it's changing because now it's including a new player, of course, the People's Republic of China. But in some other, no. The expression Cold War refer to the friction between two dishomogeneous systems. Even there is a huge imbalance of power between the two players. On one side we have the global hegemon, the United States, and on the other part we have a regional power, the first class and very important in terms of economy, but it's not the same level in terms of military capabilities. It's a huge difference. While the relation and interaction between the Soviet Union and United States were more or less similar, even the imbalance of power between the two players was huge. But in terms, for example, of nuclear power capabilities, Soviet Union and United States were more or less the same. Of course, they were different in terms of economic power. So there are similarities in the use, and there are some new dimensions. However, I think that exactly we're looking the same, we can detect the same process we looked at in the 50s or in the last part of 50s, a sort of polarization through the use of these expressions. I think it's very dangerous, of course. And I can see that an oversimplification in that time, for example, overshadow one of the most important processes in the international system, the rise of a global south, the decolonization process, which is a function of the Cold War in the standard narrative. But it's far more important than the Cold War outcome today, the rise of global south. So in one sense, it's the same, but on the other is changing. And the dangerous things is the use in a political way.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you very much. Now we can see that we are receiving, you know, a lot of response and questions. So please limit your answer, you know, very concisely and try to finish your response in 1 minute if possible. There is a question for Jennifer. And then the question is, how could Kramer have got away from the HUAC associations for his high-profile Soviet communications? Has he ever been followed by CIA or American agents?
Yes, yes. In fact, he wasn't by the FBI, but he was cleared of all communist, he was cleared as never being a member of the Communist Party. And that was correct. He was never a member of the Communist Party. So, but he shows up in FBI files. He is accused by informants for being a communist sympathizer. But because the FBI cleared him, he was safe. The other major reason why he was protected, though, was he had a production deal with Columbia Pictures. The head of Columbia Pictures was Harry Cohn, who was a very anti-communist, pro-blacklist motion picture head. And Cohn pretty much protected Kramer.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for your response. And there is a question for Tarik. Well, very information though. They said that, how do we read the TV development in GDR in the Cold War and the DEFA agency and France Lucier with various TV programs and also films such as Guinea Bissau, Atlanta, and India. Also, can you say a few words about supply of film material produced at a different GDR chemical photography material plants, notably ORWO? So how do we read from this archive, or basically it's from a Stasi archive, STASI, and also about true value and absence of Stasi archives since they reconstructed many documents from torn out pieces, very specialized. So your response, please. We can't hear you. We cannot hear you. Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, now.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'll start with I see the question in chat as well. So I'll start with the last part of the question. The Stasi archives are actually accessible, unlike, for instance, the KGB in the Soviet Union had an office usually called the press office from the early 1960s onwards, which dealt with very similar issues, basically public relations. And you cannot access that material. I've written to them, to the FSB, as a matter of due diligence, and of course you can't get in. But with the Stasi, it's different, and you can access the materials of the relevant office. These materials have not been torn up. I know what the question is about, but this is something that wasn't shredded, luckily. The other important thing is that the access to Stasi materials is restricted in the sense that when personally sensitive information is contained, for instance, in informers' reports, you can't just go in and read that. People who are affected can. However, again, this office wasn't usually or not at all dealing with that type of work. And therefore, luckily, in that area, the East German case is fascinating because it's actually unusually good access to this type of archive for this particular area of work. And I've used that. And indeed, it's fascinating. Now, film materials, yes, they usually use their own film material production, their stock. It is interesting, however, that Invisible Visor or Unsichtbares Visier is so important politically and so privileged that when they ask for it, they can actually use hard currency, which was always scarce in East Germany, to buy film material stock from the West. We did have quality problems and they were aware of them. For instance, when they were working with color stock in different types of light, and sometimes they were aware that if we do it with our home production, it's not going to look very good, and we want something like Kodak or Agfa or whatever. And Visor was one of the cases when they asked, and I've seen those requests and the answers, they would usually get a positive response and would be able to spend some extra money. then DEFA is crucial indeed, because although Visor was made for TV initially, it was not made for cinema. It was, of course, produced at DEFA, which is originally a cinema film studio, the cinema film studio of one of the big ones of Germany, and then goes blah, 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 and then off the GDR. DEFA was producing all of this. The Franz Loesser is interesting here, but I'm not sure. I have to read that again, frankly. I don't see myself in how far his stuff is pertinent to this particular type of film. I would like to say something else, which I didn't have time to say in the presentation, which is that this is only the tip of an iceberg, right? The GDR, East Germany, made actually a number of intelligence films. Some of them are made for cinema, some of them are made for TV, some of them are in series format, some are standalone films. Mm. Over time, there's quite a number of them, and this is true for many East European countries during the Cold War. It's absolutely true for the Soviet Union. There's actually a plethora, a whole world of intelligence films out there. I've chosen The Invisible Visor because it's the single most successful one. In terms of popularity, very clearly, but also in terms of how the Stasi sees things. Because in 1989, just on the verge of East Germany ceasing to exist, there is an internal Stasi study conducted by, I think, four Stasi officers who are also academics. And they assess Stasi public relations over time. And they single out, and I think they're right, Invisible Visor as a peak of Stasi public relations. They're basically saying this in the 70s, that's when we got it right, and if only we could do more stuff like that.
Yes.
That's why, okay. I hopped in on this.
Yeah, thank you very much. You know, I'm quite sure that the person who raised this question would like to email you and ask for more information, because, you know, the guest, you know, who present the question seems to know all the details. That are very specialized in a kind of question. Actually, there was still one more question from Mireno, which we worry that we may not have time for you to respond. The question is, the guest wonder how was George Orwell being received in the United States? So I hope that they can write you and then you can correspond. So. Okay. Very, very grateful, you know, for the panel, and due to the time constraint, we only have 10 minutes to begin the keynote speech, which is by Nafi on a Pakistani Picasso for the Cold War, which should start, it is the filmmaker lecture. It's the shortest speech, right? It is by Noreen Mahanaman from Columbia University, which will start in 10 minutes. So, you know, this is just, the session will end now, and then please log in again in 10 minutes. I will give an applause to all my panelists, which are wonderful. Thank you very much.